Welcome back. Well, as many of you know, as researchers, we quite often visit the Chernobyl Exclusion Zone. And there is one thing you always pay attention when you are there: radiation levels. They actually differ very much from place to place, but what was less known is that they actually tend to fluctuate depending on the season, weather, and many other factors, and it is quite interesting to keep an eye on it. And so, today I will show you how to build the most insane radiation monitor ever. This thing fetches radiation readings from a vast network of monitoring stations across the Chernobyl Exclusion Zone. But that's not all, because it also has a built-in Geiger counter, and it presents all that data along with temperature, humidity, atmospheric pressure, and current time on this stunning vintage plasma display. All documentation, software, and models are free, so you can find that by the link in the description below. So you may want to build the same or something different, because our solution is pretty universal. Besides, we are looking for a cool name for it, so if you have some ideas, share them in the comments below, and the best suggestions we will feature in our next Chernobyl Tech episodes. Let's start with this amazing display, which is called Elektronika MS6205. Many people wrote under announcement posts that they would like to have the same, and I think it's a good idea if I explain some important things about this device that you unlikely find in English-speaking sources. So, these displays were produced here in Ukraine at the Gazatron factory in the city of Rivne from the early 80s and up to around 2005. Why so long? Well, we'll come to that. But what's far more important, during this time the device passed a few redesigns, so they greatly vary in their capabilities. Technically, all of them are based on a built-in display module EMG102. That looks like this, a matrix and two circuit boards with wires coming from it. The main element is a plasma matrix of 100 rows of 100 pixels. That's basically two layers of glass, between them is a grid of electrodes separated by an insulating mask, and all that is sealed and filled with a special gas mixture. And when a high voltage is applied, it ionizes the gas, and at intersections appears a beautiful orange glow. And just saying, there is no flickering in reality, it has a steady glow. For now, let's pretend this board is not here, and what remains is exactly EMG102. It has these two circuit boards that allow selecting a pixel to glow, nothing else. There is no interface here, no buffers, no nothing. You had to add those yourself depending on what you were building. And that's why in this original form this module was used just in a few Soviet oscilloscopes, because it was really hard to use as is. Later, three more boards were added, which contained a power supply unit, character ROM, interface controller, and RAM. And this in result became a text-only display called EMG103. Then, with some further improvements, it became Elektronika MS6205. Both devices look the same, and both are text-only displays, 10 rows of 16 characters, and these row separators always glow. But here you may ask, okay, if I buy such a display, can I make it output graphics? Well, with some effort, yes, but you will need to design a brand new controller and make some changes here. But why were these displays produced even in the 2000s? This is because in the early 90s, here in Ukraine, based on it, was created a currency counter called Banknote 1. These machines could be found in almost every branch office of a certain state bank, and there were thousands of those offices across the country. They turned out so reliable that I personally remember seeing them still running in some places around 2010. So, Gazatron factory continued to produce these displays to meet demand for spare parts. And so, I strongly advise you, so if you look for such a display on eBay or elsewhere, aim for one produced after 1995. This is because these later versions were even further improved. There are not three, but just one controller board inside, there are better capacitors and less exotic ROM storage. Or if you are lucky, you may find a rare variation where a major part of electronics is replaced with just a few chips. But the coolest thing is that these later versions have one undocumented feature we will use for our radiation monitor. That's a hidden set of characters you can unlock. By default, out of the box, MS6205 supports just 96 symbols. Those are uppercase Cyrillic and Latin alphabet, digits and some special characters. What to modify exactly to extend that, I will explain in documentation, but the idea is to cut one very specific track and jump fire it to one of the connector pins. And once that's done, you get 32 extra pseudographic symbols and some Greek letters. Unfortunately, there is no letter mu, which normally stands for micro, but there is letter gamma, which will be quite handy for us. And now with the display prepared, we can now build our device, starting with connecting it to Arduino. The display has a long 64-pin SNP connector, and you have two options. You can connect here SNO6364 if you want to make a cable, or SNP5664 if you want to go for a PCB. I needed to keep dimensions compact, so I grabbed this leftover Soviet PCB that had a matching spot and cut the part designed for the SNP connector. On both sides there are power buses, and each I cut in half. That's because the display needs two voltages. First is 12 volts, which it transforms to 200 volts to start the matrix, and 5 volts for logic chips. Then, to get this voltage, I used a small 12 volts 2 amps impulse power supply, to which I added a power socket and a few outlets. 12 volts go directly, and to get 5 volts I added this tiny board with two DC-DC converters I pulled from my previous projects. One powers a micro USB cable for Arduino and another a power line for the display. And this is what we got. Well, looks a bit crud, but I am eventually planning to order a proper PCB. For now, this will be enough. I also added this little jumper that connects one of the pins to ground, and when it's open the display shows a cursor, which is quite useful for debugging. Now let's test it. So from the display to Arduino goes 12 wires, 8 for the multiplexed address and data bus, plus reset, strobe, address wedge and signal ground. For now I will switch off some lights, because the display actually isn't very bright, but later I will show you how to improve its contrast. And when powered on it shows random characters. That's because the memory is still in random state. But now let's run the test program. For now the jumper is closed, so there is no cursor. And then if I remove it, the cursor appears. And since the device has to connect to Wi-Fi to fetch remote radiation data, a usual Arduino won't work, because it has no connectivity. And so instead I grabbed a hybrid node MCU plus ESP board. One part handles display and another connection and parsing. Also, I wanted to have an onboard Geiger counter, so for that I got this compatible expansion module called Kajoy Radiation D. It needs just one data pin for signal and 5 volts of power, which you can supply either from the Arduino itself or external power line. The module gives counts per minute, which you can later convert to microsieverts per hour. Well, from my point of view it's very hard to call it accurate, because it's based on the unshielded glass detector, vulnerable to EMC, light and everything. So better shield it with red foil or even replace it with the Soviet SBM-20 detector, that is much better option. But for our prototype, as is, it will do the job. And given I still had some free pins, I made this chain of real-time clock and two sensors. They provide atmospheric pressure, temperature and humidity. They all run on 5 volts and connect to Arduino via the SCL-SDA bus. Next I made this plastic chassis to secure all the components and mount them behind the display. That's how it looks in place. Additionally, I will add a cover over the Geiger counter to protect its detector. Then I replaced the screws holding the display enclosure with stands, and that let me firmly secure all hardware, turning it into one big electronic block. Obviously, easier to work with. And then to improve visibility in bright light conditions, I will add a 3mm layer of red acrylic filter. That's quite common for these displays, because it greatly improves contrast. For now I will secure it with pieces of adhesive tape, since we will add another color. And now we need a case for all of that. So I decided to make it an 18cm or 7-inch 3D printed cube, which consists of three parts. The central part has 14mm clearance for the display and electronics with a lot of ventilation holes. That's quite important because everything heats up during operation. The front panel is a rectangle with the extra 2.5mm border. That border will hold a glossy decorative panel, similar to this educational computer where MS6205 was used as the main display. And finally, the back panel is just a plate with an opening for power connector and a power switch, and over it will be positioned the power supply. And here is what we got. But before final assembling, I wrote the software. The core of it is fetching remote radiation data. From our previous episodes, you may remember that the Chernobyl Exclusion Zone has a vast monitoring network for radiation levels. This data is aggregated into a few systems, but I chose SaveEcoBot. That's the most convenient one. It is actually a really cool project which is available in many languages. So there is this map where you can browse all detectors. Some may be offline, but many are up and running, and you can click and see the readings, and they differ a lot from location to location. But the coolest thing for us that SaveEcoBot actually has an access API. So you can ask them for a key and then use two main requests. The first one gives you IDs, names and operators for all monitoring stations, and the second one gives you readings. But since IDs don't change, I eventually selected 25 interesting points and hard-coded their names to fit the display. They are located in different places in the zone, so that gives us nice variety. But when I programmed and tested all that, I realized I made a big mistake, because I forgot the SaveEcoBot output is way too big for Arduino RAM. So eventually I changed the controller to ESP32, which has more memory. And luckily nothing changed in the wiring, because all components including the display work fine with 3.3V logic levels. And now a few final touches, so I mounted everything inside, securing it with plastic corners. Then connected power lines, closed the back lid and bolted it all together. Finally I placed 4 pieces of adhesive tape on the front, cleaned the screen once more from Fuzix cations and added the decorative shield. Beautiful, and now test run. On power up, the device waits for a half a second for the display to properly start. Then appears the welcome screen followed by a short animation. And then it runs a quick self-test of sensors. And if all is well, we get the main screen and see the connection status in the third row. Once data is fetched, it turns into a solid line visually separating the screen. Radiation data shows in groups of 5 locations, switching every 10 seconds. New data comes every 5 minutes, because that's how often many systems update. If a value is higher than was registered before, you get an arrow up in the corresponding line, lower, arrow down, the same, dash. Well, now all are up, because this is the very first fetch. Next, at the bottom we have local gamma readings from the built-in detector. Well, sometimes the value spikes to something abnormally high or falls to something very low or even to zero. That's because it's not only the detector is unshielded, but now I also update the value every few seconds for the demonstration purposes. Well, a more correct approach for the real use would be to collect CPM readings many times per minute and then calculate the average, and that will give us already a normal background level. But that's just a change of few lines of code. I also added a histogram showing trends using 3 pseudographic symbols. And finally, at the top we have a real-time clock and alternating temperature, humidity and atmospheric pressure. But if you decide to build the same, I suggest placing the temperature sensor outside, at the bottom of the device. I left it inside intentionally, because I'm more curious how warm it gets around the display during operation. The good news is that after 2 hours of constant work, temperature stayed below 28 degrees Celsius, which is perfectly fine for a 3D printed case. This is just the basic functionality, so as you can see there is a lot of room for extra features, because the solution is very flexible. So please feel free to rebuild, improve and share your ideas in the comments down below. Complete documentation and software you can find absolutely for free on our Patreon page. Once more, it is for free, but this way you'll be able to get updates from us as we surely will continue improving this project. And if you want much more, with membership there you get access to countless posts with Chernobyl research data and unique insights we have gathered over a decade in the Chernobyl Exclusion Zone. Speaking of which, very soon we'll have a big update on our Chernobyl control room project. If you are new here, long story short, we are building a precise, functional replica of one of the most iconic reactor control panels. Recently we got exact dimensions and we will soon begin metal works. Thank you for watching and we will see you in the next one.